thinking of a master plan.
Howdy, folks. This is Jordan here with Keith for the Really Rad Dad podcast, episode 3. It's crazy, Keith, we're already at number 3, but we're rolling, man. We are, I've got a lot to go over today. We're recording this on Monday, the 4th. I'm sure we'll have it out today, but just in case not, May the 4th be with you, Keith.
Ah, that's right. May the 4th be with you, sir.
Right, man. That's right. And I also, before we jump in here, I just want to point out, I just noticed that your shirt, Saturdays Are for the Dads.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's awesome, dude. Very nice. Very nice. Yep. So what's going on, man? What's new? Anything?
No, just the typical craziness of everything in the world and dealing with it. We just had a talk before we hit record on this, and it's just COVID craziness with the baby. It's just tough to deal with everything, but we're getting through it. We'll be stronger for it, be stronger parents. So, you know, it's whatever, but yeah, you know.
Yeah, man, I hear you. We are, you know, not in the same boat you are, but we're stuck here, and the most we do to get out is just go for walks. So we're aching to get out. We're aching for some social, not distancing, but we'll do it if we need to. And like you said, we'll be stronger for it in the end.
Yeah. We went for a walk the other day, and there's at least 50 people out. I'm like, okay, we're turning around, like at the park. Right. So we went to a different park. It was better, but anyway, so. All right, let's get into it. Let's do wild NFL names first. How about that?
I like it. Let's do it.
Wacky NFL names. Yep. It's always funny. You know, you see the Key and Peele, like, names. Yep. And there's some real-life ones that are far off here. So I'm going to start with my top 5 list here. I got Jabril Peppers, it's always been a hot one. Nice. Solid name. You got Rock Ya-Sin from Indy. solid, pretty solid second year corner, actually, too. I don't think it's too bad. Minkah Fitzpatrick, always a catchy one. Yep. Taco Charlton just got cut and signed. And then a rookie, Javelin Guidry. That might be my favorite one.
That's a good one.
If you're naming your kid Javelin, you're just boss.
I know.
My all-time favorite, DeBrickashaw Ferguson, long-time linebacker.
That's the one to me that sounds like a Key and Peele.
And then my favorite baseball name of all time I'll throw in there, Kirby Puckett.
Kirby Puckett. Well, so my top five are not necessarily in this order, but Ha-Ha Clinton Dix. Mm-hmm. Just never have understood the first name, Ha-Ha.
Yep.
Then I got Captain Munderlin.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Captain, I like that. I like that as a first name, Captain.
Boss name.
Barkevious Mingo.
Yes, I forgot about Barkevious
Mingo. Another name I feel like is a Key and Peele sketch, Barkevious Mingo.
Yep.
And then here's one that I'm probably going to butcher, but it's so crazy to me. Laurent Duvernay-Tardif.
Oh, from the Chiefs.
Lineman from the Chiefs, yep.
Yep.
Yep, and then not necessarily like a super crazy name, maybe more so because we've just heard it for so many years, but my favorite name of all time, TJ, say it with me, Keith.
Hushmanzada.
That's right, TJ, who's your mama?
Who's your mama?
That's my favorite there. But after I came up with my list, I went over to Bleacher Report, or not Bleacher Report, I Googled it, and then Bleacher Report article popped up with some interesting names just throughout all of sports. Check out some of these that that Bleacher Report popped up. Dick Trickle.
Yeah.
Our guy.
That's a real name.
Let's see. God Sham God. Pro basketball. Rabbit Moranville. Baseball. Old timer. Danger Four Pence. Boots Day. Wolfgang Wolf. I could go on and on, man. Wow. There are some names out there.
Definitely, boy. Like, some older baseball players, like, in the 40s and 50s, too, that have, like, wild ones. You're like, people name their kids that?
Yep. How strange, man. But this was – Keith came up with this segment, and I had fun with it because there are some good names out there.
You know what? Actually, it's funny. My wife, we're eating dinner, and she was actually saying, you should have a segment with, because we're watching the end of the draft, or I was just watching something. She passed by and she was like, some of these names are crazy. She drew a list of all these crazy. I'm like, You know what? That's a great idea. So shout out to her.
She shout out Emily. Great job. That's an awesome segment.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they're no Hingle McKringleberries, but.
Yeah, sir. That's a good one, man. A good way to start out episode 3.
Yeah, really. So let's roll over to NFL current events. I got a hot one coming out the gate here. Let's go. NCAA football, is it coming back? It's been a hot topic. If you follow NCAA football on YouTube and all the, you know, there's all these fake over the last few years, like, it's coming back, it's coming back. But no, there's some real traction now. Yep. I think 2022 would be a reasonable time for it. Field Yates tweeted out, the NCAA board announced it supports a rule change that would allow student athletes to receive compensation for third-party endorsements, both related to and separate from athletics starting in 2021. This is coming off of the heels of, in October, the NCAA approved players from benefiting from the use of their name, image, and likeness. Mm-hmm. So now those two things really, for me, cleared the way for NCAA football. I still play NCAA football 14. We talked about it in the first episode, I believe. There's a community of dedicated folks out there on Operation Sports that update rosters, and they come out like every July area. Mm-hmm. And they're pretty accurate in ratings, everything, down to the 50th person on the roster. So I want the real thing, and I cannot wait. I'm hoping, they're saying 2022 would be reasonable because everything would be allowed in 2021. Let's go. Let's go. I know a couple years back, actually, EA Sports tweeted out a photo of like a, what's like the heartbeat thing?
Yep.
And it was through the EA NCAA football. This was 3 or 4 years ago. And then they had to go back and say, that doesn't mean we're coming out with anything, because at that time, all these rules weren't in effect, but we're pretty set now. I think they're going to do it, because a lot of people are just screaming for NCAA football to come back.
Right.
So, and then hopefully that comes back soon. We've got Jaron Reed from the Seahawks. I got here. He switched his number to 90 the other day. Yep. So you know what that means for the Jadeveon Clowney sweepstakes. Like you were saying, I'm going to give you some credit here.
Episode, yep.
Yeah, they're done with him. I think they are completely out, especially if as an organization they're letting him change his number, the upper management saying, you know what, change it, fine. Yep. I did a little more research this morning on it, and apparently Cleveland has reached out to him and the New York Jets have also.
Okay.
And early this morning, it was reported that he bought a house just outside of Cleveland. I don't know if that means anything.
Really?
But I was actually thinking the other day, I'm like, you know what? Some wacky team like Cleveland is probably going to swoop him up last minute. Because, you know, like they like to get those guys that want to prove it maybe a little bit.
Yep.
They've got $38.4 million in cap space right now.
Okay.
The highest in the NFL, actually. So I think it's highly possible that they bring a guy like that in, especially since they just cut Olivier Vernon. We'll see. I feel like we just go into depth on Clowney every episode now, but people got to understand, like, this is a prime, like, free agent. That would be a top five in any free agency class. And we're in May now. So, so enough with the Clowney news. Carson Wentz had a baby girl. Last week, I believe on Monday. Yep.
That's Carson and Mrs. Carson.
Yep. So congrats on that, guys.
Because you know they're listening. So congrats.
Yeah, guys. Right. I know. He was going to come on to the show last week, but they had the baby, so they had to, you know.
A little busy. Oh,
yeah. We'll let it slide this
time. We understand.
Yeah. So Andy Dalton was cut. I actually had to update this headline because he recently got signed by the Dallas Cowboys for 1 year, $7 million.
Yes.
Incentives up to $7 million apparently were reported this morning. But he's going to make $6 million if he sticks around for all 16 games of the season.
Yeah.
I'm just going to, as an Eagles fan, go into it real quick. Yep. People are bashing him for the Hurts move. $6 million for 4 years for a guy that probably plays at a similar level.
Yep.
But nobody's bashing an eye when they go out and get Andy Dalton, who started for 9 years, and right. he's making $7 million in 1 year. So all I'm going to say about that, Mama said, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it at all. So just going to back off.
Especially because they'll use Hurts in the offense.
That's the other thing, too. At least they're going to use him.
They're not going to use Dalton unless Dak gets hurt.
Mm-hmm.
So that's crazy. It's wild.
I know. So that's just funny. My buddy Tim was telling me that looks like a lot of teams are getting two, like, quality starters right now. Right. Like, there's a lot of teams that can have two guys because – there's just a lot of depth at quarterback right now. It's really something I've never seen, or if I have, it's been a really long time.
Mm-hmm.
It's great for the NFL, I'll say. Mm-hmm. So, because Winston, I mean, he's – if you look at it and what the Saints are saying, Taysom Hill is their second guy.
Right.
Winston's kind of their third stringer right now, and he just threw for 5,000 yards. So, what a world we're living in. Right.
Just such an offensive league that, I mean, a lot of teams have two guys that could start.
Yeah, absolutely. So now with Andy Dalton getting cut, going away from AJ Green, there are only three teams in the NFL with a quarterback wide receiver combo that have played together for more than 4 years. Matt Ryan and Julio Jones, mm-hmm. Aaron Rodgers, Davante Adams, that's 5 years. Russell Wilson and Tyler Lockett, that's also 5 years.
Yep.
So
it's crazy.
I know. We're also like, we're almost in like this NBA sphere where like all these guys get traded so often. It's just been wild the last 4 or 5 years, 3 or 4 years maybe. These guys are just like these stars of the NFL, faces of the NFL are just going to other teams, and it's kind of normal now.
Yeah, it's the new norm. It's
wild. So we got a top five list. Ding, 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 ding. Let's go.
Well, hold on, Keith. I have a few NFL current events, we'll call them, that I'd like
to. All right, to yeah, let's do it.
First, you buy into this. There was an anonymous AFC exec, or I don't think scout, but just somebody in the AFC that said they were worried that they think, either they've heard or they just think, that the Pats may be tanking this upcoming season to get into the Trevor Lawrence sweepstakes. You buying that?
Nah. I never can put the Patriots in the tanking conversation.
No.
The last few days, I mean, people are talking, and they think Stidham is the guy, and they want Stidham to be their guy.
Right.
I don't think a team has ever purposefully tanked in the NFL, but if there was a year, this would be it.
This would be it.
This would be okay. it. Because Trevor Lawrence is a generational talent. Let me just reiterate that again. Like, he's going to change the face of your franchise. He's better than Luck in his junior year coming out.
Right.
So, I think
so if maybe.
Yeah, I mean, there's a possibility. Honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if teams started doing that.
Right.
Carolina, I think, are going to fall into that. They have a pretty poor roster right now, and I like Teddy Bridgewater, but can he lead them, you know, to – I don't know. That roster is rough. That's a rough roster. And then Jaguars, I think they're going to be up there in the running for him, but the thing is, I think Minshew just wins you games. I think they're going to get 5 wins if he starts 16 games, you know. So we'll see what happens, but this might be a year that a team or two tanks.
Right. We'll see. I don't know. Interesting.
Yeah.
And then I saw that, again, more just rumors, hearsay, just whispers that the Packers drafting Jordan Love was a subtle shot to Aaron Rodgers. The words that were used were, you don't run this.
Yeah, I saw that.
Like letting Aaron Rodgers know he doesn't run the organization, and they do what they want, and it's up to them, and he has no say and no control, and it's not his team.
That's wild.
I don't know if that's true. I can't imagine that they are, quote-unquote, sick of him. It's LaFleur's first year. What are you sick of? Aaron Rodgers getting you to the NFC Championship game? Like,
right, they just got to the NFC Championship game. Like,
you know?
What more do you want from the guy?
Right. I don't know if I'm necessarily buying that that's the thought inside the organization behind Rodgers' back, but it makes sense if it is.
There's a lot of reports out there, like too many, I think, that some of it, I think some of it's got to be true at least.
Right.
That basically they purposefully didn't draft a receiver. You wouldn't want to think that an organization would do this to one player.
What a way to prove it.
Hurt Jordan Love in the process because he has great potential.
Right.
But they didn't draft one receiver. So it's like, what am I to expect?
What a terrible way to prove a point if that's what they were doing.
Right. And put Jordan Love in the middle of it like some kid in the middle of a divorce or something.
Yeah, right. And then, Keith, another thing that I'm sure you heard, this came out a few days ago. Again, don't know if it's true. I guess I'm big on the rumorville. But just kind of proving my point from going back to episode one, you might remember. I've heard recently that the Steelers were in on Jameis. There were reports that there were other bigger offers that he turned down to go to the Saints, and it's come out recently that the Steelers were possibly that bigger offer.
I thought I saw that.
Episode one, I was saying he'd be a good fit in Pittsburgh, so I was just found it interesting that I potentially was right.
Yeah. Well, and he turned down an offer for $27 million to go to Tampa Bay, apparently, too. And Cam Newton doesn't want to be a backup anywhere.
That was another thing I was going to say. He's not going to be a backup.
It's wild. It's like, okay, well, you're not going to get signed unless someone gets hurt.
Yep.
Because teams are set now, you know.
Right.
I think for the most part, their off seasons are done right now because of everything that's going on. No teams are going to practice for at least another month.
Right.
So, you think there's going to be an NFL – sorry.
No, go ahead.
You think there's going to be an NFL season as it stands right now?
I think that we are more likely to have a shortened season than no season at all.
Yeah. I think they're just such a money-making, machine that they'll find a way. I think even if that means not allowing fans at the stadium, which would be so weird.
It'd be weird.
But the quality is definitely not going to be there if it does come back early September.
Yeah, but
you might just cut preseason too, so.
You know, you'll watch it. You know, I'll watch it. They'll find ways to get it into our homes, and they'll have, I think, people that probably are just a casual fan that will tune in because, shoot, man, we're aching for something here, sports related. They'll still make their money if they don't let fans into stadiums.
Yeah.
And the last thing, this is minor, but I just thought it was pretty cool. Did you see the Bears signed Khalil Mack's younger brother?
Yeah, he actually did pretty well at Buffalo.
Darius, yeah. I thought that was pretty cool. Two Buffalo boys, two brothers, now playing for Chicago. I mean, who knows? He might not even make the team, but just thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I thought that was neat. He actually played pretty well at Buffalo, too. He had, I think, 9 sacks. Like, pretty solid, actually.
Yep.
I'm not saying he's in the Khalil Mack level, but, I mean, you take a shot, whatever, let's go. So...
Brother. All right, let's hit him up with that top five, brother.
Yeah, sorry, I got a little excited there. I jumped the gun.
No, you're good.
So let's go. This is going to be a heated argument because I know some of these are on your top list. Most overrated shows.
Okay, let's do it. I'm ready. You want to go one for five, four?
Yeah, so I'm going to say number five for me, The Voice.
Okay.
People love The Voice, okay? Do you ever see the winners of The Voice on the radio or on after this?
Nope.
What do the teams mean? I'm sorry.
I don't even watch the show if that tells you anything.
Right. And my mom loves it. My wife was watching it the other day. And
No.
So what happens when they go on the team and they win it? They win? Okay. So it's just funny to me because it's it's so hyped up and everyone, it's been on 10 years now.
It is popular.
It's just funny because it's so unnecessarily dramatic. Okay. Like right, the chair will be turned around.
I know.
They'll hear a song. It'll be I don't know, American Pie. And they'll be oh, American Pie. And I'm like, the guy hasn't even sung yet.
Right.
Calm down.
Yeah.
And then as soon as a rhythm comes out of their mouth, boom.
Yep.
And I'm in. It's okay, this is crazy. So that's my five.
So for me with my list, I couldn't really necessarily give it a 1 through 5 rating. Like this is the most overrated and this is overrated, but not quite the most. So this isn't necessarily in any order, but for the sake of a top five, I'll give you my number 5 as The Big Bang Theory.
Okay.
I used to watch it. I used to watch it.
Yeah,
well, I wouldn't say big fan, but I've watched it. It's funny. But for the amount of seasons it lasted, for the amount of people that have watched it, and for the amount of reruns that they air, I'm always seeing Big Bang on. Like, come on, guys. This isn't that good of a show.
Yeah.
It's just too much. It's too forced to me. Like, the way that, like, some of the characters act, it's just too forced. It's not real life. Like, come on.
It really is.
Glad it's over with.
Yeah, same, definitely. I got number 4, Keeping Up with the Kardashians.
Yeah, that should be number 1.
It might be, honestly, because it's like, what did these girls do to get this money? Like, they just got it from her mom who got it from their father. Like, I'm sorry. All they do is argue, and, like, they hit each other sometimes. Like, they're verbally abusive towards each other, and people love it.
He knows because he tunes in.
Yeah, people love it. My wife was watching it the other day. What are you doing?
You gotta talk to your wife, man.
Like, why is Kylie Jenner, like, famous? What has she done? She's made $1 billion. Doing what? What are we doing
here? She's the richest of all of them, I think. No, I don't know the names, but I think it's that one.
It's insane, yeah. And it's just, like, people are so enamored with what's going on in their world. And it's, like, it's always in the magazines. Kim did this. Khloe did this. It's like, why do we care so much?
Why do we care?
Yep.
So for me, ironically one of my favorite shows, and I'll explain why I think it's overrated. Game of Thrones.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
So, I almost put it for number 5, but I was scared at the reaction.
So one of my favorite shows, but here's my logic. Here's my reasoning. I didn't jump on the Game of Thrones wagon early on. I wasn't watching it week after week, season after season. I jumped in very late and binged it. And unfortunately, it was one of those shows where it just didn't live up to the hype. I think it was hyped up so much that you go in with these expectations and you go in thinking it's going to be amazing. And it was. It was a very good show. But how hyped up it was and how much people loved it. And then especially, too, how it kind of ended. You've seen Game of Thrones, right, Keith?
A couple episodes, just because my wife watched
it. Emily's seen it more so than you have.
Yeah.
He ended bad.
Yeah. And I'm sure that's what I heard, too. I heard there's like a dark scene where nobody could see anything.
Yeah, it just, the hype that it got as someone who didn't start from the beginning and jumped into it because of the hype, it didn't live up to it for me, especially the way it ended. Now, maybe if I watched it from the very beginning and went episode by episode, sometimes when you binge a show, just kind of all gets jam-packed into one and you don't, I don't know, it's just not as good. So Game of Thrones, number 4, most overrated show.
Yeah, I think I was talking about it a little bit. The first episode, I'm watching Vikings. And I think if you watch that whole series through and then you watch Game of Thrones first or second, you're going to say, okay, there's not much of a difference here, like in quality, honestly.
Right. Yeah,
I think Vikings really stands on its own at points. And I'm like, why was this show not more popular? I think part of it is the network you're on too, right?
Sure. Yeah.
So it's like, if it's on HBO, I feel like it's like boosted up to a certain level too.
Right.
Number 3 for me, The Walking Dead.
No way.
So yours, you got it too?
Not there, but I have it.
Okay. So like the first, second season, I loved. Great show. Season 3, it just fell off a cliff. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching it whole season 3. I'm like, okay, it was kind of a boring season. I just wasted about 10 hours of my life. Okay, I'll give it a shot. Go to season 4.
Yep.
Okay, same deal. Really nothing is happening. They're out in the country doing nothing.
Yep.
They're like milking cows. I'm like, okay. season 5, same deal. I'm like, okay, I'm probably not going to start watching this anymore.
Yep.
Season 6. This is where it like seriously deviated from the comic books, apparently, too. Mm-hmm. It just got too out of control. It was like okay, what's going on? I can't even follow what's going on anymore. They're just trying to be crazy to be crazy. Right. And then Rick Grimes died, and that was it for me. And
spoiler.
I'd say for 50% of people that watched it, that's when they were out too. They're like, oh, Rick Grimes is done, I'm done. Yeah. And it's still on, and people still are, there's a pretty good following still of it. So, I mean, but I think it came out so hot that people just continued to ride it through.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So my number three, I'll keep this quick and simple, is Lost. I never watched it, never seen an episode, and I think that tells you enough. I'm the type where if it's a show that's getting a lot of hype and a lot of people are watching it, sure, I'll check it out. If I've never checked it out, that tells you something. It's bad, I guess. I don't know. It's people loved it, and I've never even tried, never even watched an episode, so. Get lost.
Yeah. Even my buddy, one of my best friends there, Tim, I was talking about, he watched it all the way through, and he was like, man, there are some parts where I was just so frustrated. Like, he's just like, I could see why people didn't like this.
Yeah.
It's like his all-time favorite show.
Oh, okay.
But even he is like, okay, I get it. Number two for me was Big Bang, and this is why I didn't touch on it a whole ton. I genuinely tried to sit through like 3 or 4 episodes.
Uh-huh.
I like giggled a little bit a couple times. I'm like, I'm trying to like objectively, like, is this funny? I'm like, that was like lowbrow humor.
Right.
And that was like a lot of the show when I watched it.
Yeah.
And like you were saying, they tried to like force like the relationships, and it's like, oh, you're hot, but I'm a geek. Okay. Let's make this a thing. Like, okay. Funny.
Right.
But that's my two.
Number two for me is, and let me preface it, I'll do this quickly, with I'm a very OCD person. If I start something, I have to finish it, especially like with a book. Even if it's a terrible book, I'm going to finish it. If it's a show that I've started and it's a terrible show, I'm going to finish it. I'll typically give a show like one season. If I don't like it after one season, then I can stop. I'll be done with it. But if I've invested a few seasons because it was good early on, even if it gets terrible, I've got to finish it. Number two for me is The Walking Dead. And that's why. First few seasons were great. Everyone was into it. I was hooked. Now it's terrible, but I'm so OCD that I have to finish it. So I'm still watching it just to see how they eventually end it, however many seasons that's going to be. But it is so bad. It is so bad, dude. I'm so sick of it. I just want it to be over with, but I can't. I got to finish it. So
number two. I get that. Number one for me is Friends.
Okay.
I actually like the show. It's a good show. I wouldn't say it's great or amazing.
Right.
But like the level of comedy, I feel like the crowd audience like pumps it up. Right. If you don't have crowd audience in it, there's videos on YouTube if you want to see it too. It's incredible.
Really?
You're like, oh, okay, well, that's not actually funny, because why is that funny? You hear a crowd and you're kind of like, it's like an audible like brainwash thing. You're like, oh, that's funny because they're laughing. A lot of it, I'm like, oh, that's not funny. Those videos got me so messed up. After I watched that, I'm like,
check them out.
I can't do this anymore.
Yeah. Yep.
So
I say you take out Joey and Chandler, because to me they are funny. You have no show.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So my number one is another show that I've seen start to finish. And I just watched, they came out with a movie on Netflix, kind of like tying up some loose ends about it, but Breaking Bad.
Oh, wow.
Yep. Whoa. Number one most overrated show of all time.
Bomb.
Yep. I'm dropping bombs on this episode, Keith.
Really?
I just think, yeah. Again, it was a show that I didn't watch from the start, so I had to binge it.
Okay.
And it got to a point where I was just like, I'm ready for it to be done.
There are definitely some boring points in it where you're like, okay, what's going to go on here? Yeah. I get that.
Early on, it was great. I was hooked, but it just got – I think for me, they just dragged it on too long.
Yeah. I can see – that's kind of what Better Call Saul is. The whole show is just dragged on for, like, things that you don't, like, care to watch.
Right. Did you watch El Camino, the Netflix movie?
I did. It was pretty good. I liked
that. That was good.
Yeah.
That was good.
Yeah.
Well, that was a good segment, Keith. I like that. Top five. Yeah. We had a few. It's funny. We had a few Walking Dead, Big Bang that we definitely agreed on there.
Right. Absolutely. So let's go. Let's do off-season draft grades. We're going to try to sum this up and get a little quick because we got a little behind there, but no big deal. Let's do off-season grades. We've got the NFC and AFC North. I've got the Vikings at a B-plus for the off-season for their grades. Rick Spielman and Patton is his last name. They trimmed a lot of the fat, actually, this offseason. I mean, they went and spent it in the first place in the last few years, but they kind of made up for it, and it's what they did this offseason.
Yeah.
They replaced, you know, holes and got it in later draft picks. They still don't have a whole ton of depth now. They need a little more from their role guys. Their future looks solid, though. They had 15 draft picks. We were talking about that earlier.
Yeah, it's crazy.
They got rid of Everson Griffin, and they actually drafted Kenny Willicus from Michigan State defensive end. He's supposed to go, like, round three or four. They got him. He almost went undrafted.
Right.
So they could actually have a potential replacement in a seventh-round pick. Mm-hmm. They drafted very, very well, and for me, that put them at a B-plus for their grade.
Yep.
I still project them at about 8-8, though.
Yeah.
So you want to go with your first AFC North team?
Yeah, I'm going to hit you with Baltimore. I'm giving them an A.
Nice.
Between free agency and the draft, I think they crushed it. So last year, 2019, they were 22nd in sacks in the league. So they kind of went out and addressed that by signing Calais Campbell, or trading for, I believe. And then in the draft, they got a steal in Patrick Queen. So I think they really – I mean, he's more of an outside linebacker, but I think they really shored up some holes, we'll say, in their defense. They tagged their linebacker who led them in sacks with 9.5, Matthew Judon, I think.
Judon, yep.
Yep, they tagged him. So hopefully they'll – I think they're looking to, you know, by July to sign him up more long-term, but they at least have him for this year. Their defense is pretty solid. Obviously, we know the quarterback's situation is good for now. We'll see. I still think wide receiver is a question for them, more of a weakness than anything. Maybe a little bit of their offensive line. But overall, between the offseason moves that they made with trades and signings and who they tagged and then their draft, I'm giving them an A. I think Baltimore has had a good offseason so far.
Yeah, that's fair. A lot of people expected the Titans to beat them and just have the Ravens coast to the championship game. Mm-hmm. They were 14-2, but man, they got a lot better and they are scary.
They are.
I've got the Lions. I gave them an A. They had, if you look at the moves, an incredible offseason, especially for they're kind of been meandering in that mediocre zone like we were talking about. Yep. They added Geronimo Allison, Chase Daniel, who could be a serviceable, nice backup. Yep. Vitae from the Eagles, their left tackle, signed for $45 million. Danny Shelton at defensive tackle is just a solid, solid tackle. They traded for Daron Harmon, safety from New England. They actually, it's funny, you know, they got rid of Slay and they replaced him with Desmond Trufant, which is not a huge, huge drop off, honestly. Mm-hmm. He was banged up a little last year, but before that, he didn't really have huge injury issues. He's 30 still. I mean, he could still play very solid.
Right.
Reggie Ragland, they brought in, very solid linebacker, but going back to the corners, in addition to Trufant, they drafted Okuda, Jeff Okuda. So yep. They actually have a pretty solid secondary right now.
Right.
B-plus draft, you know, like I said, they got Okuda, they got DeAndre Swift round two, Jonah Jackson they got, who's a really solid offensive guard slash tackle, depends where they want to use them.
Yep.
I'm actually projecting them. This might be high, but I have them at 10-6 because they filled all their needs. I mean – all their needs have been filled. They could, I mean, possibly get a little more help for Stafford at wide receiver, but, I mean, they've got Marvin Jones still and a couple other guys. So, I mean, they're set. I mean, there's no reason they can't win 8 games at least this year now.
Right.
There's no excuse.
Yeah. Keith, I'm tackling your favorite team outside of the Eagles next, Cincy.
Oh, yeah.
I actually had them graded pretty high. I went back and forth on a B-plus or an A.
Mm-hmm.
So somewhere in that range, I'm probably going to maybe go with an A. I mean, they signed a lot of holes on their defense and free agency that they were, you know, needing. They signed a D tackle, cornerback. They signed a guard, franchise AJ Green. I really think that their strengths are their defensive line cornerback positions. Their weaknesses are not glaring, maybe linebacker position, but quarterback I think is a weakness. Not because of Joe Burrow, I know we disagree on him, but I just don't think they have any depth there. So that's why I kind of went away from maybe that A and more of a B plus, just because I just don't know with that quarterback room who, now that Dalton's gone, who Joe Burrow is going to, you know, learn well from. But overall, between what they did in the draft, I mean, obviously I thought they were going to mess it up and trade the pick, but they didn't. They drafted Burrow, so I'm giving them a B plus overall.
Yeah. And like we were saying earlier, it's nice to just have another quarterback in the room, especially with a rookie. Right. But if he were to go down or something crazy were to happen, you need to have that guy.
Yeah. I mean, I've looked up their depth chart. I don't even know who their backups are. Like, their names I don't recognize.
Right. I think they had Driscoll at one point, but I think he went to Detroit. Yeah.
It's Ryan Finley, which I kind of feel like I know who that is.
Okay, yeah, they drafted him last year, mid-round pick. They liked him, and he played really well in preseason, but not great.
And then Jake Dolgala.
I have no idea.
Yeah, exactly. So, B+.
Yeah, that's a good – about Joe right Burrow. About where I put it, so.
We'll argue about Joe Burrow another time.
Yeah, got a lot to argue about. Got Packers at a C-.
I agree.
They did add some guys, but nobody that's going to, like, make a game-changing impact. I mean, we said, they went 13-3, went to the NFC Championship game. And, I mean, really, it's going to be a huge drop-off for them, I feel.
Yep.
They lost Brian Bulaga, who didn't play great, but he's a solid tackle. Yep. They're replacing him with Rick Wagner. I mean, he's not great. That's not a good – I mean, that's really subtraction. Geronimo Allison went to the Lions, like I said. Jimmy Graham is gone, who's a nice red zone target for them. Zero wide receivers drafted. And if you look at their numbers, I'm pulling it up here. All of their leading receivers, let's see. You got Devontae Adams at the top, okay? And then after that, Aaron Jones, who's a running back, was second in receptions. Jamal Williams, third in receptions, also a running back. Jimmy Graham was fourth, also running it back. Then you got Allison at sixth. I mean, there's no wide receiver help still, and they did nothing to improve that offense. It's a joke. It's a joke. Like, I don't know what they're planning on. And if, you know, they did add Christian Kirksey and Devin Funchess. Funchess, though, is kind of shaky. I don't know. I don't think he could be a reliable target. And Kirksey is always hurt.
Right.
So I got them at 9-7, though.
I like it. I agree with that, Keith. It's going to – they're in that division, too. I feel like that's a pretty tough division with the Vikings.
Right.
Honestly, even the Bears started out hot. Their defense was so good last year. Obviously, your defense can only do so much when your offense is so bad. But
yeah, it just stayed on the field.
It's a tough division, honestly.
Yeah.
So I'm going Browns next, and I'm giving them an A, man. I love what they did in the offseason between moves that they made and the draft. So last year they were 20th in scoring in the NFL. I mean, a lot of that is obviously quarterback play. He definitely took a step back, but also he had no line. Their offensive line stunk. So they went out and they addressed that big time. They signed the tackle, Jack Conklin.
Yep.
And then they drafted, obviously, Wills, the Alabama tackle. So they're going to have two solid tackles. They also signed the tight end, Austin Hooper. Well, traded for him, maybe. Did they trade? No, they gave him a ton of money.
Oh, yeah, they signed him. Yeah.
They signed him, yep. Linebacker, B.J. Goodson. Safety, Carl Joseph. That's my boy. He's a very underrated signing.
Yeah.
They drafted a safety I really like at LSU.
Yep, Delpit. Great quality pick for round two.
Yep. Obviously, their wide receiver position is pretty stacked. Obviously, the hotheads and divas, we can agree on that. But they can get it done.
Production's there still.
Running back position is solid. Now they've got an amazing tight end group. They just picked up the 5th-year option on what's his name? Their tight end there.
Oh, and Njoku.
Yeah. Yep.
Yep.
So, on paper, again, I feel like this was – I was saying this last year on paper. They are a good team. But look what happened last year. So again, on paper, they are a good team. I'll give them an A, but we'll see. Paper is different than on the field.
I think it was coaching too for them.
Kitchens was terrible.
People assumed he was going to be so great because once they went through with Hugh Jackson.
Yeah, right.
Well, it wasn't that far off, honestly. And now they've got what's his name? He was the offensive Stefanski.
Stefanski, yeah,
from the Vikings. Yep. And I mean, he's a guy that gave Dalvin Cook the ball. I think it was 6 or 7 times when they got in the playoffs. And it's like, what are you doing?
He couldn't
even manage that offense.
Yep.
So I'm like, I don't know about that signing either. Some guys just happen to be better coaches, so we'll see. But I don't know. I didn't like that move either. So I think they definitely have the potential. They're a 10-win team if you get them a solid coaching staff and the right guys.
Right.
So I got the Bears, actually, for my last team, C+. They had a C draft, no real help that they added that's going to contribute day one. They didn't have a first or a third because of the Khalil Mack trade a couple of years ago there. They had 2 second-rounders. One of them they used on a tight end that's a little suspect.
Yeah.
Holcomb, he's solid, but why are you using a second-rounder on a tight end when you have glaring needs? They extended Danny Trevathan, who's 30, and he missed 19 games the last 4 years, rather than your boy, Kwiatkowski, who was the linebacker that signed with the Raiders in the offseason.
Pretty excited about him.
Yeah, and he's 27. I mean, I think he's due for a great season. He had 76 tackles last year. This was only on 512 snaps, which is 48% of the team's total snaps. Okay. So he was used sparingly and still produced at a very high level. Right. When he was in there, he was in every play, it seems like. He had 8 tackles for a loss last year, too. Very, very good in coverage, too. People don't realize. That's something that really gets dropped by the wayside with these linebackers. They added Nick Foles, which, you know, I think that boosted their grade up a whole letter almost just because of the potential you have with them. I still think he's a little injury prone, but we'll see.
Yeah.
Jimmy Graham they added, Robert Quinn they added, who had great production, but he's going to be 30 this year, and they gave him 5 years, $70 million, so not very smart.
Right.
Brian Burns, cornerback that was in Pittsburgh, very solid young corner. I like that signing. But the losses really don't make up for that. They lost Burton, who had signed that big contract. They lost Leonard Floyd, Taylor Gabriel, and Prince Amukamara. I will say they signed an offensive guard, Jermaine Afidi, who had a great season with Seattle, but it's just, I don't think they added enough. And I think they're actually going to take a little step back. I think they're going to go 7-9 this year. It's just not a great team. They lost Clinton Dix, too. I forgot about that. So it's just a lot of key guys on that defense.
Yeah,
it's, I don't know. That defense has carried that team, but it's just the front seven that's solid right now, and they're kind of, I don't know. So, that's my NFC North offseason grades.
Good, Keith. I like it. I agree with a lot of that. I'm going Pitt, my last AFC North team, and I'm giving them a B-, which might even be a stretch. Oh, well, I think in the draft I gave them a C. Maybe in free agency, a B+, so average it out to be about a C-. B-. But I just really don't feel like they address some of their bigger needs. I mean, they didn't have a ton of draft picks. They only had 5 draft picks. They traded for Minka Fitzpatrick, which technically that was mid-season. If you want to include that in this offseason because it was a draft pick this year, then they did have a good free agency period offseason because he's a stud. We know that.
Great
move. But I'm not chunking him in that. That was mid-season, so take him out of it. Yeah, B-. I mean, they were last 2 seasons, they were 31st and 29th against for their passing, their rushing attack. I'm sorry, pass rushing attack. Obviously, they have TJ Watt, but not enough. And I don't feel like they did enough to address it. They did draft, which I think this was a pretty underrated pick. Alex Highsmith is a D end.
Okay.
Maybe can help him out there, but I mean, to be 31st and 29th in your pass rush the last 2 years, I just feel like they didn't address it enough. They franchise tagged their linebacker Bud Dupree. I'll give him that. I feel like that was pretty pretty good tag. They did end up bringing in Eric Ebron, the tight end, which drops a lot. I think he dropped a lot more so in Detroit. He played pretty well in Indy before he got hurt, but we'll see. That could go either way. And then they brought in both of our former boy, Stefan Wisniewski.
Oh, right. That's right. Back in Pennsylvania. Yep.
No sexy moves there other than, you know, trading for Minka during the season last year. Five picks in the draft, so didn't really address their glaring needs on the D-line.
I was surprised. Usually they draft really well, too, and that was just kind of like a meh year for them.
I think they just had they had a second, a third, a fourth, and then a sixth and a seventh. Those are
right. I was surprised that they didn't tag their defensive tackle, Javon Hargrave, because he produces at a very high level. I mean, he's borderline the top 10 defensive tackle. Right. They used him as a nose tackle, but he could play a little bit of end, too. They let him walk, which was a little confusing. Again. Good for me, because he went to Philly. He's going with Fletcher Cox. So they're going to – I mean, you can't double-team Cox anymore because Hargrave will get you. He's the grave digger. The grave digger. So love that nickname, by the way, too. So I've actually always really liked him because he was like a combine-like warrior. Right. He killed all the combine drills. Mm-hmm. I remember he weighed something like 350 and he ran a 5.0 40. Like, this is crazy. It was like just under five.
Wow.
And like just all the measurables with him, everything. And I mean, this guy is just balled out. And he came out of a really small college too. I think it's like SC State or something like that.
Okay.
Loved him. Glad he's on my team.
Right.
Yes, sir.
But, so that's our NFC, AFC North grades for NFL offseason moves. We're going to cut to the would you rather portion. Getting to the end of the sode here. We're going to have bonus content for you guys after this, too, so make sure you tune in for that.
Right.
So we've got would you rather. For NFL, we came up with would you rather have a coach/GM situation? Would you rather have a guy kind of like Gruden? Or a coach non-GM, a guy that kind of just controls everything on the field. You give him the guys, he makes it work like a Doug Peterson. Yeah. So I'll let you go first.
So I'm going, I think more so just because this is what I would want, not necessarily from my team that I'm a fan of, but if I was to be employed in the NFL, this is the situation I'd go with. Separate, keep them separate, a GM who's just in charge of that aspect of it. And then the coach who will coach up who the GM decides to select. I think a lot of times you're just going to have too much butting heads. If you are like a Bill O'Brien, I feel like you're just going to have too much like butting heads with, I don't even know how to word this. Like, I just picture the Bill O'Brien situation with like DeAndre Hopkins. Like, it's not your guys, so. I don't know, Keith. This is a tough one for me.
You burned a lot of bridges for sure with that move.
And a lot of bridges is what I'm trying to say.
So why are you doing this?
Right. I think if you have it, you hire a GM who brings in his coach, it's just a more fluid situation. Whereas if you're trying to do all of it, it's just too much pressure. It's just I don't know. I think I'm going to
imagine the quality of life, by the way, if you're doing all that.
Right. It's a lot, man. Say goodbye to your family because
you better not have a family because you're in it. Just to go the other route on you, just to kind of go against, I will say coach GM, because look at Bill Belichick, look what he's done over the years.
You're right.
He I don't know this guy. There's no, you know, no wonder why he's so grumpy and miserable.
Right.
He's got no spare time. But he's won six Super Bowls. So what's, you know, but
it works, man.
Yeah. So this year, I wouldn't be surprised if they won 9-10 games. I would be surprised if they won two games either. But anyway, I just think they had another solid draft. And because he's going out, putting in the work with the binoculars, you know, like the the memes, you know, where you see someone gets released, he's like, you know, he does the work and he scouts these guys out totally. People don't understand what he does behind the scenes. And you know, I'm in the land of Patriot haters in Buffalo area. So it's like people don't want to hear it that are up here, but he's the greatest coach of all time. But he's the greatest coach slash GM of all time, too.
Yep.
So, I mean, it's just they had another solid draft. And you know what? They're probably going to win a ton of games again, too. Yep. So, but let's see. Let's do a real life one. Would you rather have no hands or no feet?
Why don't you take this one first?
Okay. So I'm going to say no feet because I want to get robot feet. But if we're going – if we're
like a dream here.
Yeah,
a dream of yours to be able to have robot feet.
But if this is the situation, right? So I came up with this. I'm like, I'm not like super stoked about it, but let's get into it. Let's make it work.
Yeah.
No surgery, no additions. It's got to be either stubs here or stubs there.
Okay.
So I think, you know, I watched King of the Hill. And I see Hank's dad. He's got his shins blown off. Yep. He makes it work. He's walking around on those nubs. Yep. So I just think, how are you going to grab things?
Right.
That's my...
Well, I'm going to hit you with the opposite.
Okay.
I'm going no hands.
Okay.
Just have everybody do it for you, man. Have people feed you. Go do your grocery shopping. Turn the channel for you. I mean, things would be a piece of cake if I could have people taking care of me. If I can't go out for a walk or get out of the house.
That is true.
I'm going stir crazy now. Yeah. I have everything. So imagine not having feet. You can't get out. You're just stuck.
That's true. I didn't think about it like that.
Let me get out. Let people take care of me. That's good living.
Yeah, that's funny. I never thought about that, I guess.
Actually, if I'm being honest, though, I'm probably going same as you, but I can't agree with you. I gotta change it up on you. So
I like those are good points, though.
I convinced myself, maybe.
Yeah, right? And then you got some would you rathers?
I got a would you rather. All right, Keith, would you rather? Now, this is like for the whole season. You can't switch it up at all for the rest of your life, the whole season. Would you rather wear summer clothes in the winter, nothing but summer clothes in the winter. So we're talking tank tops, shorts, flip-flops, summer clothes in the winter, or winter clothes in the summer. Now we're talking, you know, hats, gloves, winter jacket, boots, the not, you know, all the way. Winter in the summer or summer in the winter?
I would say winter clothes in the summer. Okay. I would rather be too hot rather than too cold. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to tell you why. My house was built in 1920. I don't think the windows have been replaced since. Yeah. Super drafty. I'm always cold. We need new windows. Holler, window people. Holler at a boy. I'm always cold. And I'm like, I can't do this. I need like warmth. I'm just fiending for this 70-degree weather. I just want 70-degree weather. Mm-hmm. So that's my answer because I'm sick of being cold.
So, all right. So you are going – you're going winter clothes in the summer.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, you're wrong. Because there's nothing worse than being too hot. You can grab a blanket if you're too cold,
get
man.
A fan. Come on. Get a fan.
Come on, dude. Grab a blanket. There's only if I'm too hot, there's only so much I can do to fix that. If I'm too cold, I can keep layering and layering and layering.
Okay.
So I guess in my situation, you can't do that. I understand that. But just from how I am normally, I'd rather be cold. I could do some jumping jacks. So give me a tank top in the winter. Give me some shorts in the winter. I'm wearing shorts right now. Like, it's – let's go.
I feel like it's so much work just to stay warm, though.
Drop it like it's hot.
I don't want to have a heat stroke, man.
I'm just, like, sitting on the couch watching TV. Like, I'm not even sitting on the couch. I'm like, all right. Oh, that was a good one. Huh.
You want to mow your lawn in August? In a hat, gloves, winter jacket.
Like. Yeah, that's true. I was mowing in shorts the other day, and I was hot, and it was 60 degrees. I put an ice pack on my neck. How about that?
Summer clothes year-round. It's the only way to do it.
Yeah. So some good topics here. Yeah. You got any more? Or we good?
That's it, man. I'm just hitting you with that one this time. We'll save some more for another time.
Oh, yeah. I've got some saved up, too, already. So... cool.
Good, man.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone, for watching. Make sure you hit like, subscribe on YouTube, and follow on Twitter and Instagram.
That's right.
Take it easy, people.
Thank you, guys. See you next time.
And we out of here.
Yo, what happened to peace? Peace.